during the entire summer, we invested in learning what it is to cultivate a godly character. And one of the things that we learned is not something that comes natural to us. It's something that is given to us by God. And then we accept that and we allow God's transformation to happen in our lives. So for all these different Sundays during the summer, we learned 11 different things that are talking about what it is to be in godly character. So I am so proud of you guys. Give me five, because we learned a lot of things together. And we're going to learn the very last one today. And actually, I want to encourage you to come next Sunday big time, especially with Oasis, because next Sunday we're starting a new sermon series of the very last book of the Bible that we promised we were going to do all the books of the Bible. You know how long it took us? 4 years. 4 years. So the very last book that we need to learn is going to be next Sunday. Do you know which is it? Not the very last book of the Bible. The very last book of the Bible that we need to learn. Okay, I'll give you come next week and you'll see which is. All right? Okay. So, but one of the things we have learned through this is we are people who can be transformed and used by God as if it was cultivating with plants. And we had all these new terms, and we're going to have a new one today. And this is the term called tiling. Do you know? I practiced it and I did it right at 9:45. Tell me again. Tilling. Tilling, tilling, because I remember Tilly, Tilly, our friend here from the church, Tilly, Tilly, okay, tilling, right? Do you know what's tilling? Any of you here? All right. Tilling is necessary if you plan on mixing amendments into your soil. Plus, it's also helpful if you have compacted soil that needs to be broken up. Tilling helps remove the unwanted roots and weeds from the soil. In other words, it helps to all that soil that is probably very compact. It helps to bring air so you can do a better planting. There are different ways on doing this. Some people can do this like in big, with these machines, and it's for long pieces of land. But also this can happen in smaller places, even by hand. So it's just a way to bring the opportunity for a new growth. You see, this also makes me think about specifically this Sunday. Somehow, we can become a place and we can become intentional in preparing the soil for the next generation. Each of us here have a connection with children and youth, isn't it? Some of you are your own children, your grandchildren, members of your church, people you work with, right? We all have connections with children or young people. So somehow you and I have the capacity of becoming a source for them to be able to have a place where they can grow and a place where they can learn more about Christ. The situation that is very difficult today is that we have a generation that is bombarded with information and options of life constantly, isn't it? My fear is that a lot of those messages are not the best for them. We are seeing a high number of young kids being committing suicide. That is something that never happened before. But it's happening a lot right now. We're finding a lot of young kids not understanding about their lives. They are really confused. And in many of these cases, when you start talking to the child, you realize the child is just perhaps the scapegoat or the kind of the image of what's going on at home and what's going on with the generation that is raising him or her, isn't it? So how is it that we can be able to prepare the next soil so they can be in a place that is healthy? One of the things that we learned with David is, as Nate was sharing, David was an amazing man of God. He had a lot of great characteristics, but we also remember there were some areas of his life that he was weak. But what he learned is, even though in those places, he learned to come back to God. That's what makes the difference of a person with a godly character. And what he also did is that he was so excited about his relationship with God that he wanted to do that temple for him. But God was very specific with him and he said, no, you're not going to do this. You have been a warrior. Your ministry has been a lot about that, about killing and people. That is your ministry, but we're going to leave that for your next generation. But you see, David didn't think, well, you know, I'm going to let just my children figure that out, and I'm just going to be nice here and enjoy what I have. No, he did not do that. He said, you know, I'm going to prepare things so when that moment comes, when my child is able to create, to do this temple, he has a lot of resources with him. The first thing, as we learned last week, he gave the piece of land where that temple was going to be. And it has a very deep meaning. If you remember last week, that's the place where David was able to come and have an altar before God to reconcile himself with God after a big, big mistake. So he said, you know, this is the place where people will be able to reconcile with God through this temple. He also provided a lot of resources. And that's the scripture that we read today. All of these things, he was gathering them so people could have them ready in the moment that they will start with the construction. And he also had a vision of how does this temple should look like. And he didn't just leave it in his mind. He even kind of gave the blueprint to his son Solomon and said, you know, this is kind of where I see this going. All of this planning shows one thing about David. David's priority was to glorify God and prepare a godly character generation. Guys, do you want these children that we have here and the youth to be a godly character generation? You see, to get there, we need to be a godly character generation, you and I. Now, is it impossible? No, it is possible. It is possible, but that requires that you and I take a step of commitment and take that seriously and say, you know, God, I want my life to really become a way where these young people can see how does a Christian person looks like. We give a lot of examples, and the sad thing about the Christian testimonies is the bad testimonies are the ones that everybody knows. We all know about scandals of churches. We all hear about the scandals of priests and pastors. We all know that very quickly, right? But the celebrations of good things, that's those things that they are not known that quickly. But the point in here is we need to become a loud voice of how does a strong Christian person looks like. This congregation is rich in so many gifts. We have a congregation of diversity. By you guys being here, sitting with people from other cultures, from other places of the world, and being together through Christ, we are showing that people of godly character loves the community that surrounds them and loves diversity. Amen? By you being here, people of different ages, children and adults, and people that are super young and people that are super old, and we all accept them, is that we say we value every single stage of life. Amen? By all of us being here, we also understand that we validate men and women as God's created and a way that we can glorify God. Amen? But you see what's also beautiful, and we have shared this before. This is a congregation that actually can show how those women and men, the same percentage of men and women in this church, are showing how does a person with godly character looks like. Many churches have a majority of women. This church is highly, highly diverse in the sense of having also men. And I believe it's because that's a purpose. And the purpose is that we are called to show to this world how those men and women look like with godly character. And I encourage you to take that as part of a strong call that God has given to all of us. Now, with all of this, we also need to remember that we also are prepared to tilling. We have the different gifts and talents to do that. And we need to clarify, how does that look like? How does a person today looks like? Because I don't think we should look like this mother. Just pay attention to her.
Sending your little ones to school for the first time can be a tough transition. As parents, we want to ensure that our kids are as comfortable as possible in their new environment. The first step is packing items to prepare your kids for whatever little emergencies arise throughout the day. Consider including a special item, like a blankie or a stuffed animal for comfort. It's great to send them to school with an extra layer in case it gets chilly. Just keep this on all day. You may also want to provide your teacher with a list of your child's likes and dislikes. And you shouldn't feel like you need to wait for parent conferences to really get to know the teacher. anybody asks, this is not a camera. You should also familiarize your child with her future classmates.
He's allergic to dogs. Oh, Madeline keeps kosher. Okay, Ariel over here, she has a fear of quinoa. Giles is fluent in Mandarin, so that's probably someone to become friends with.
Getting to know the actual room is helpful too. Here's the sink to wash your hands after you touch the class hamster. If you're worried that your kid will miss you, send her with a photo of yourself that she can look at throughout the day. And leave extra time to get out the door in case they have morning jitters.
No, I'm not ready. 5 more minutes.
It's hard for kids to let go.
Give me a hug. Okay. You're gonna be fine. It's gonna be fine, and I'm gonna pick you up at the end of the day, okay? All right, okay.
Okay, how many of us will have been there? I mean, confess your sin. I have been there. I remember dropping my kids last year, and I was like, okay, let's take you to the classroom, and both of my kids are like, I can do it, Mom, by myself. You don't need to come. And I'm like, yes, but I cannot. I need to go with you, you know? We'll go through that moment. But you see, she's trying to prepare her child for the next generation. I'm not sure how successful she is on that. But God is telling us through the scripture, and especially through the example of David, how can I prepare a person to go through these transitions in life and be strong in this world that we have? And perhaps the place where we can see is in the way that David sings and prays. And we find another prayer from David, almost one of the last things that he does, and we find in the scripture from David, is a prayer. And if we read it slowly, we can see that it goes also with what we have learned during Wednesday night, the Acts prayer of adoration, confession, thanksgiving, and supplication. It is through this prayer that we can see how David is trying to recenter the next generation to understand who is God and how to rely to God. We find that on 1 Chronicles 29:10-19. And we find adoration. Adoration says, praise be to you, Lord, the God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. What is he's saying in that moment is he's telling to the people of Israel, you know, God has been with us even before you and I were born, and he will be with us even after we are in this world. And you see, as a parent, there are many times since probably children in kinder all the way to probably even college, that there are a moment when you feel anxiety that you say, I need to send my child to this world and I cannot be with him or her. As it happened to you, you feel that anxiety. I remember one friend telling me, I wish I was a little mouse that hides in the backpack and just follows him to be sure that my child is safe. Does it happen to you? It doesn't matter the age of your child. You feel that anxiety to be sure that the child is okay. And one time I was telling that to God and saying, God, are you sure that my children are going to be okay? Are you sure that they're going to be safe? And God clearly told me, Lupina, you love them, but I want to remind you that I love them even more. And that gave me peace. But also that gave me assurance that God is developing his own conversation, his own love with each of my children, as he does with each of the children that we have here. But we remember that wherever they go, God is already there. God has already been able to manifest his glory in that place. So we adore and praise that God, saying, you know, God, you are here, but you are also part of my future, as what Tom was praying today. Confession. While confessions, many times we connect that with a need of forgiveness, there is also another way of confession, and it's a confession of remembering who is the one who has the power, who is the one that is transforming lives. I remember this scripture is beautiful. It says, wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. He's telling that to all the community. It says, in your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. So through confession, you understand who is in charge. Is it you or God? It's God. He's the one who provides everything to all of us. There are many times where we think, I am the one who owns things and I share with God. Don't we have that mentality? Is that the right mentality? It's the opposite. It's about me saying, you know, everything that I have belongs to who? To God. And then God allows me to use his resources so I can serve and glorify him in different ways. I shared with you before one story of a person who's a very famous singer, Marcos Witt. Actually, Byron worked with him before. And Marcos Witt, one time, he purchased a truck. And as soon as he purchased this new truck, and he was so excited, it was the very first truck that he owned. And he was driving back, and he felt in his heart that God told him, you're going to give this truck to another person. You purchase this truck because I am calling you to give it to a person who needs that. And he said that while he was riding the truck, he was thinking, probably I'm just distracted. I don't believe that God is just asking me to give up my truck, the best one that I have had. Maybe it's that I just ate too much enchilada. Something is wrong, you know. So he goes home. And he thinks, the best thing I can do is tell my wife. And of course, she's going to say, are you crazy? And then I'm going to say, yes, I was. So let's keep the truck. So when he goes to the house and he tells his wife, you know, I felt like if God, you know, kind of crazy, God wanted me to give the truck. And the wife looks at him and says, go ahead, give the truck. Obey the Lord and do that. And he was like, are you sure? The new truck that we just bought? Yes, go for it. And he says that after that, every time that he goes and gets a new car, he says, okay, God, so who is this for? Because it seems that now I'm the car dealer of the community, you know, just giving away. But, you know, it's true what happened to him. What we have is not ours. What we have is so God can use that to empower you to do his work. We are just using that for his glory. And for the sake of giving to others what God is providing to all of us. So a confession, think about when you teach your children. When you know that everything that you have is God's, their mentality about how they perceive their things is very different. Then the next thing is thanksgiving. The scripture says, all these things I have given willingly and with honest intent. And now I have seen with joy how willingly your people who are here have given to you. As we remember in confession, we remember who's the God of power. In thanksgiving in here, he's telling us how the power of his own giving, David gave a lot of his own resources toward the temple. But by him doing that, he set an example. And then the community did the same. There are times when you and I, part of our godly character is going to be to set an example and show, am I tithing to the church? Am I giving to the congregation? Through that, we set an example. This church has been very powerful in that. If you look in your bulletin, it talks about how much money has been raised for the ministry center. Do you realize that we're almost done with the amount of money we raised and we are half a year ahead? Isn't that great? And that is not because we are all cute and wonderful, although you are cute and wonderful. It is because of what? It's because God has been faithful. And because many of you say, you know, God, I'm going to give a little bit more for this ministry. Help me to do that. And God has blessed you to even do that. Even people who have moved from here, they send their check and say, because I trust in what God is doing in the ministry center, I'm going to keep helping in that. Isn't that great? But that's the way we glorify God in thanksgiving. And the last one of supplication, there are two sections that are beautiful in here. The first one, it says, this is David praying for his people. Keep these desires and thoughts in the hearts of your people forever and keep their hearts loyal to you. You know, I have a new president in Mexico. I don't know if you're aware of that, but we have elections. If López Obrador will pray that for every Mexican, we will have a revival in my country. And I will be the happiest human Mexican in the world. Just think about if your leader will be praying that. And you see, we perhaps are not a leader as a king, but you are a person of authority through Christ. So wherever you are, you can pray that prayer. You can go and say, God, I pray for the hearts that you keep the hearts loyal to you, to those who are in my family. I pray for the hearts to be loyal to you, God, on those that I work with. I pray for those, God, for the hearts of those who like me and even for those who do not like me. They don't need to like me. I don't need to like them either, but I can pray that their hearts are loyal to you, right? It's not about who's the most loved person in the world. It's about them keeping loyal to you. And Lord, I pray for the school where my children are going to go. I pray that the heart of the people that work here are loyal to you. I pray for my leaders. I pray for my political leaders. I pray for the leaders of the churches that their hearts are loyal to you in the name of Jesus. You and I, as people of godly character, as people who know the truth, are capable to preach in that authority so that things can change. If we commit ourselves to pray like that, we will see a revival among us, and we will see a generation that looks very different. And people are going to ask, why are these kids so different? And we can say, because people of godly character raise them together. When we baptize a child, remember that at the end I ask you, you need to also do this prayer. You commit your life to help that child to grow in their faith. And we take that very seriously here. That's the next part of the prayer. It's very special because now here we find David praying for his son. And it says, and give my son Solomon the wholehearted devotion to keep your commands, statutes, and decrees, to do everything to build the palatial structure for which I have provided. In here, this statement was very powerful. Wholehearted devotion. When you look that in the original, it comes from these words. Shalem, heart. Now, shalem is very familiar to another word that you and I know well. Which one? Shalom. It comes from the same root. And what it means is that help my child to be so in fullness of you, God, of your presence. They understand so clearly who they are in you, God, that there is no room for anything else to come in their lives. Just think about if we send every child with that mentality. If we say, you know, you are a person created in God's image. You are a person that has the capacity of being able to say no to temptation. You are a person of value, and we are proud of you. And do not let anything come and lie against you. If we tell that to every child in the name of Jesus, it doesn't matter what they confront in the world. They will understand their identity in Christ. There won't be any room to allow them to try any other way of understanding themselves, but they will be able to keep strong in their faith. So when he is saying to the Lord, David, Lord, allow my child to have that shalem heart, it means that he's saying, let him understand his identity in you. Now, as Methodists, this is what Wesley understands of that term. It's a constant obedience. It means not a person that is perfect. It's a person that is capable to know this is the right choice. This is the right choice. Now, we're talking about the next generation, but maybe some of you and me here are feeling, you know, God, before praying for the next generation, I need to pray for myself. I'm feeling in need of that. I want to remind you that in the Lord Jesus Christ, we also find that prayer. The dealing for our next generation is what Jesus Christ did with us in John 17:17. That's the key of Jesus' prayer. And it says, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. That is the prayer that Jesus did for you and for me. And that is the prayer that will allow to all of us to be able to really cultivate a godly character. So today I invite you that you come to God and you say, God, I need that shalem heart first. I need you to understand, I need to know who am I for you. And that will fulfill my heart in such a way that I won't give room to any distraction to try to take me away from you. And when you allow that shalem heart to be the one that leads you, then through that, start interceding for every person that surrounds you. Start interceding for your children. Start interceding for the people that work in your office. Start interceding for your family. Start interceding for every person that you know with the authority that you have in Christ. And through this, we will become a powerful, real church that has the capacity to reach, teach, and love in this place. Amen.